Read a book every day for small children. Pinocchio. Have you ever wondered if wishes really do come true? Well, they do, and I, Jiminy Cricket, have seen it happen. Here, let me tell you about it. One starry night, my travels took me to a tiny shop owned by Geppetto, the wood carver. I sneaked under the door and saw old Geppetto working on a puppet that looked like a little boy. Geppetto put on a last dab of paint and said, "There, little wooden head, you're all finished. Now I have just a name for you, Pinocchio. Come on, let's try you out." Geppetto took Pinocchio down off the workbench and danced the little puppet across the wooden floor by pulling the strings. Figaro the cat wasn't sure he liked the newcomer who clomped and clattered around the shop. But Geppetto liked his little Pinocchio very much. "Figaro, wouldn't it be nice if Pinocchio were a real live boy?" "Oh, well, it's time for bed. Come, Pinocchio, let's put you back on the workbench. Good night, my little funny face." Just before going to sleep, Geppetto looked out his window into the starry night. "Oh, look, Figaro, the wishing star. Do you know what I wish, Figaro? I wish that my little Pinocchio might become a real boy." And with that, Geppetto drifted happily off to sleep. "A very nice thought," I said as I settled down to bed in an empty matchbox. But wishes like that never come true. Moments later, the room filled with light, and there stood a beautiful blue fairy. She tapped Pinocchio with her magic wand. "Little puppet made of pine, wake. The gift of life is thine." Then Pinocchio moved.
"I can move, I can talk, but how?"
"Because tonight Geppetto wished for a real boy." "But remember, Pinocchio," warned the blue fairy. "You're not a real boy yet. First, you must prove yourself brave, truthful, and unselfish, and you must learn to choose between right and wrong."
"But how will I know?"
"I'll help him, Miss Fairy," I said, jumping onto the workbench. "In that case, Mr. Cricket, I appoint you Pinocchio's conscience." And with that, she vanished. When Geppetto woke up and saw Pinocchio walking and talking, he was amazed.
"It's my wish come true. Oh, Pinocchio, my boy, I'm so happy."
"Me too, Father."
And the two of them danced around the shop, laughing merrily. The next morning, Geppetto sent Pinocchio off to school, but there was a terrible hiding along the way. A sly fox and a crafty cat convinced Pinocchio that the place for a puppet without strings was the theater, and they steered Pinocchio away from school and off to Stromboli, the puppet master. Stromboli put Pinocchio into his puppet show that very day. The audience poured in to see the little puppet who could sing and dance completely without strings.
"Yes, sir, Pinocchio was a big hit. I told him he ought to be in school, but he would not listen. Besides, he was making so much money that I figured I must be wrong. Little did I know."
In Stromboli's wagon after the show, the greedy puppet master took all Pinocchio's money and then locked him in a cage.
"This will be your new home, my little wooden gold mine."
Pinocchio shook the bars of his cage.
"No, I don't want to be an actor. I want to go home. Let me out.
But Stromboli only laughed and slammed the wagon door. Ha ha ha! I found poor Pinot crying in the dark.
I should have listened to you, Jiminy. Now I guess I'll never get home.
Just then the blue fairy reappeared. Pinocchio tried to cover up his predicament by lying, but with each lie his wooden nose grew longer and longer.
You see, Pinocchio, a lie keeps growing until it is as plain as the nose on your face.
I'll forgive you this once, but this is the last time I can help you. She waved her wand and in a twinkling, Pinocchio's nose was back to normal and the cage door opened.
As we headed for home, Pinocchio heard about a wonderful place called Pleasure Island where boys were allowed to break windows, smoke cigars and stay up late. It sounded fishy to me, but Pinocchio wanted to go. He climbed aboard a coach full of noisy, foolish boys. All I could do was tag along. At Pleasure Island, Pinocchio joined all those rowdy boys in wrecking furniture, throwing mud balls and playing pool. I knew this place wasn't good, so I tried to talk Pinocchio into leaving.
Look at yourself. How do you ever expect to be a real boy?
Oh, gee, Jiminy. A guy only lives once, you know.
All right, stay. Make a fool of yourself. And I left.
As I headed for the boat dock, I noticed some sinister men herding frightened little donkeys into crates. The strange part was that the donkeys were wearing boys' clothing. And some were crying, "Mama, Mama." Then it hit me. These were bad boys who had turned into donkeys. I had to get Pinocchio off Pleasure Island and fast.
I dashed back to the pool room hollering, "Come on, Pinocchio, we have got to get out of here. The boys, they have all turned into donkeys." But I was too late. Pinocchio had already sprouted donkey's ears and tail.
Oh, Jiminy, what will I do? Help me.
We have got to get away from here before you get any worse. Follow me, Pinocchio. We ran into the water's edge, dove into the sea, and swam for the mainland. Pinocchio pulled himself from the water, still wearing ears and a tail, but he was glad he had escaped Pleasure Island.
Let's go home, Jiminy. I want to see my father.
When we arrived at Geppetto's workshop, the place was locked and Geppetto was gone. Just then, a magic door flew by and dropped a note.
Pinocchio, it's about your father. It says he went looking for you and was swallowed by a whale named Monstro.
Poor Pinocchio thought his father was done for, but I read on.
Wait, he's alive. It says he's living inside the whale at the bottom of the sea.
Pinocchio squared his shoulders.
Whale or no whale, I've got to find my father and rescue him.
But Pinocchio, it is dangerous. This monster can swallow whole ships.
I've got to go to him, Jiminy. Goodbye.
With that, Pinocchio ran to a high cliff over the ocean. He tied a rope to his tail and jumped into the water. The rope took Pinocchio to the ocean floor where he began his search for Geppetto.
Father! Father!
Pinocchio's search wasn't long. Monstro was busy swallowing up tuna fish for a meal, and Pinocchio was swept into Monstro's belly along with the fish.
Geppetto was surprised. Pinocchio, my boy, I'm so happy to see you. Me too, Father. I've come to save you.
No, Pinocchio, there is no way out. Monstro only opens his mouth when he's eating. Then everything comes in, nothing goes out. Suddenly, Pinocchio had a tremendous idea.
Father, we will build a big fire and the smoke will make Monstro sneeze.
Pinocchio
Pinocchio and Geppetto started a blaze and then climbed onto a raft while the smoke curled upward toward Monstro's nose. The giant whale sniffed and snorted and finally sneezed. Ach! The little raft right out of his mouth. Pinocchio and Geppetto had escaped safely, but Monstro was angry at being tricked. He raced toward the tiny raft with a terrifying look in his eyes. Geppetto shouted, "Paddle, son! He's trying to crush us!" Monstro dove underwater and then came up fiercely underneath the raft. Pinocchio and Geppetto were thrown into the air as their raft broke into 1,000 pieces. Geppetto floundered helplessly as he watched the furious whale turn about. "Look out, my boy! Here he comes again!"
"Hurry, father!"
urged Pinocchio, but Geppetto was too tired to swim anymore. "I cannot make it, son. Save yourself."
"No, father, I won't leave you."
Pinocchio grabbed Geppetto's shirt and swam bravely for shore. Just as Monstro dove at them, Pinocchio pulled Geppetto to safety behind some rocks. Geppetto woke to find himself on shore out of danger, but poor Pinocchio was lying deathly still in the pounding surf. Geppetto tearfully carried Pinocchio back to his workshop and laid the motionless puppet on the bed. Suddenly we heard the blue fairy's voice. "Pinocchio, you have proved yourself brave, truthful, and unselfish. Awake!" Pinocchio sat up to find himself changed into a real boy. Bursting with joy, he and Geppetto danced about the workshop. And so you see, wishes really do come true.